Yes. Now we'll discuss about the history of the Isca. Here you can see this is Isca. This is Isca. Isca is a skeleton of head. It can be divided into two parts. One part, this part. This is brain box, upper part. This upper part is calvarium or brain box. So this is brain box, and this part, this frontal part, anterior part here, this is facial skeleton. So it can be divided into two parts, upper part, that is calvarium. It is also known as brain box. It is made up of 14 bones. And second part, that is facial skeleton. It also includes 14 bones. So this is, this part is brain box. Here roof is removed. So this is brain box, and this part is facial skeleton. This facial skeleton includes this mandible also. Facial skeleton. So there are several methods of the study of the skull. One method, you can study individual bones like frontal bone, parietal bone, ethmoid bone, sphenoid bone individually. And another method, you can study skull as whole. If you study skull as whole, then there are two methods. A study of the external features and study of internal features. Suppose this is skull. Here, first of all, we'll study the external features. What you are seeing the on external side. After the external feature, then we'll study the internal features or interior of the skull. So external feature or exterior of the skull and interior of the skull. So here you can see there are several positions. This position, if you see this like this, skull like this. This is norma verticalis. If you see from anterior side, this is the norma frontalis. If you see from lateral side, norma lateralis. If you see from posterior side, norma occipitalis. And this inferior view is norma basalis. So we'll discuss about these norma, and after this we'll discuss about the interior of the skull. So first of all, norma verticalis. If you see norma verticalis, this is skull. Here you can see like this. This is norma verticalis. Here you will find several bones and sutures. Sutures. This bone, this bone is frontal bone. This is frontal bone. And these are parietal bones. bone of right and left side, and this bone is occipital bone. Occipital bone. So frontal, right and left parietal and occipital bone form the norma verticalis. This is norma verticalis. This is norma verticalis. This is frontal, parietal and occipital. And sutures, here is coronal suture. This suture is coronal suture. This is coronal suture between frontal and two parietal bones. This is coronal suture. And between these two parietal bones, here, this suture is sagittal suture. Sagittal suture. And here, you can see this is lambdoid eye suture. This is lambdoid suture. So this is lambdoid suture. So you have seen bones, sutures and some other features. Here, this is meeting point between coronal suture and sagittal suture. This is bregma. This is known as bregma. This is meeting point between coronal and sagittal suture. This is bregma, this part. And here, this is lambdoid suture and this is sagittal suture. This meeting point is lambda. This is lambda. Here, during childhood, during infancy, infant life, after birth, you can see a gap. This is known as anterior fontanelle. In newly born baby or infant, you can see here is a gap. This gap is membranous gap. And this gap is known as anterior fontanelle. So here gap is present. This is membranous gap. This is known as anterior fontanelle. This gap is formed by these bones ossified in membrane. This is known as membranous ossification. Here, center of ossification, side here. So, like this, we ossify. So at the time of birth, this is center of ossification around this, the bone ossified here. So this membrane is ossified here, 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 here. But here, this part is unossified. So that's why a gap is formed here. This is anterior fontanelle. This gap is filled by bones. Because this ossification continue and gradually this become filled like this. So it become filled during the age of 18 to 24 month. In 18 to 24 months, this anterior frontanel is held. Below this 24 A, below this filling, before this filling, you can assess in infants or children below the age of 2 years or 24 months, you can assess the degree of dehydration in severely dehydrated infant. Here a depression is formed, cupping is formed, which show severe dehydration. And if there is bulging, then it show increased intracranial pressure. So if there is depression, then you can assess the degree of dehydration. If there is bulging, you can assess increased intracranial pressure or tension. And by this, you can also assess age of the child. Because before 24 months, it is open. And after this, it is closed. So, this is clinical importance of anterior frontanel. And the frontanel is here. This is posterior frontanel. Here also membranous gap is present here, and this membranous gap is filled up to 2 or 3 months after birth. So up to 3 months it is filled. And here you have seen the meeting point is Bregma. Here is lambda. Another thing, important thing is here, it is a foramen. This is parietal foramen, is present in the parietal bone. There are 2 parietal foramen. This foramen lies about 2.5 to 4 cm to 4 cm anterior to this lambda, this foramen. And through this foramen, emissary vein passes. And between these 2 foramen, this point, the point between these 2 foramen, this point is known as ovilion. This is ovilion. And here, this is parietal protuberance. This is parietal protuberance or parietal tuber. This is parietal protuberance or parietal tuber. Sometimes in about 3 to 8% cases, here a suture is present. This is known as metopic suture. Metopic suture. It is present up to 3 to 8% cases, this metopic suture is present. And in most of cases, this suture disappears about the age of 6 years. About the age of 6 years, this becomes disappeared. So, this is Narma verticalis, or the superior view of the skull. This is Narma verticalis. Its highest point in this bone is highest point. This is highest point is known as vertex. This is the highest point. So here lies highest point of the skull is known as vertex. Highest point lies here. This is known as vertex. So, and on left side also two lines are present. These are the temporal lines. If you see here, here is temporal line. This is temporal line. And this highest, this is occipital, this is protuberance. This is parietal protuberance. And this is frontal bone. Here you can see, this is suture. This is suture. Here is suture. This is frontal bone. This suture. Here is lining of the suture. You can see. This is suture. This is coronal suture. And here in midline, this is sagittal suture. And posteriorly, there is lambdoid suture. Lambdoid suture. And this is parietal eminence or protuberance. And here you can see, these are the foramina. You can see parietal foramina. This is parietal foramina. So, frontal to parietal, and this bone is occipital bone. So, this is all about the norma verticalis. Thank you. Yes, now we'll discuss about the norma occipitalis. This is posterior view. This part is norma occipitalis. So we'll make a diagram. Here you can see, this is position of sagittal suture. This is sagittal suture, and here is this is lambdoid suture. This suture is lambdoid suture. The bone, these two bones are the parietal bone. This is parietal bone, posterior part of the parietal bone. Parietal bone, posterior part. This is parietal, posterior part. Here is parietal foramina. This bone is occipital bone. This is squamous or flat part of the occipital bone. And this is mastoid. Mastoid. This is part of temporal bone. Mastoid part of temporal bone. Mastoid means breast. It is like breast. So this is mastoid part of temporal bone. So in norma occipitalis, you can see all these bones. And sutures, this suture is sagittal suture. This suture, from here to here, this is lambdoid suture. Lambdoid suture. This is lambdoid suture. And here you can see, this is parietal, between parietal bone and mastoid. This is this suture, this part is parieto mastoid suture. So this suture is parieto. Parieto mastoid suture. And then Here you can see this is occipital bone and this is mastoid bone, and this part of this suture is from here to here. This is occipito-mastoid suture. This is occipito-mastoid suture. Occipito-mastoid suture. And here you can see the joining point. This point is point where this lambdoid suture, parieto occipital suture and parieto mastoid suture and occipito mastoid suture, three sutures join. This point is known as STD1. Here, a membrane gap is present, that is known as posterior lateral fontanelle. Posterior lateral fontanelle. Posterior lateral fontanelle or mastoid fontanelle. At this side, this membrane gap is closed around the 12 months. So this meeting point is known as STD1, and in infant life there is a gap known as membranous gap. It is known as posterior lateral fontanelle, and this fontanelle closed about 12 month of age. 12 month of age disclosed. And here, as you know, this point is, this is lambda, meeting point of sagittal suture, and lambdoid suture is lambda. And here posterior fontanelle is present. It is closed during second or third month of life. During second and third month of life or age. So this is lambda, and here is posterior fontanelle. This is posterior lateral fontanelle. This closed around the age of 12 months, and this closed around the age of 2 to 3 months. This membrane is there. And the thing, here a foramen is present in the mastoid bone. This is mastoid foramen. Through this foramen, emissary vein passes and emissary vein communicates with the sigmoid sinus. Here emissary vein communicates with the sigmoid sinus. This is dural venous sinus. So emissary vein passing through this communicate with the sigmoid sinus, and one artery is passes through this. This artery is branch of occipital artery. This is branch of occipital artery. This branch is meningeal branch of occipital artery. So meningeal branch of occipital artery passes through, and vein is emissary vein. Vein is emissary vein passes through and communicate with the sigmoid sinus. So this is mastoid foramen. And the important thing is present here, This is external occipital protuberance. Here one protuberance is present. This is known as external occipital protuberance. This is external occipital protuberance. And from here to margin of the foramen magnum, this is external occipital crest is present. So external occipital protuberance, external occipital crest, and from here transverse line arises. This is known as superior nuchal line. This is superior nuchal line, and this line and external occipital protuberance, this forms borderline of the head and neck. Above to this, head is present. Below to this, neck is present. So it is demarcation line between head and neck. Below to this, neck. Above to this, head. This is superior nuchal line. Nuchal means neck. Superior nuchal line. This line is superior nuchal line. And the line, inferior nuchal line is also present. And in some cases, highest nuchal line is present. This is highest nuchal line. So highest nuchal line, superior nuchal line, inferior nuchal line is present. You have seen lecture of the scalp. Occipitofrontalis muscle. Occipital belly of occipitofrontalis muscle is attached with the highest nuchal line. If highest nuchal line is not present, absent, in case of absence of this highest nuchal line, then superior nuchal line gives attachment to the occipital belly of occipitofrontalis muscle. So here, on medial side of the superior nuchal line, it gives origin to trapezius muscle. So trapezius muscle arises from here on medial side. And also ligamentum nuchae, ligamentum nuchae is attached. So trapezius, ligamentum nuchae, and in lateral part, there is insertion of sternocleidomastoid muscle in upper part, and in lower part spinous carpus. Spinous carpus and sternocleidomastoid. So these are the line and protuberance present on the occipital. And one important thing here is, this is most prominent point in the center of this protuberance. This is most prominent point present in the center. This is known as ilion. This point is known as ilion. Just above the ilion, here you can see here, another point is present, that is known as occipital point. This occipital point is important because if you measure occipital point from occipital point to glabella, this is farthest point from the glabella. If you use calipers and measure, this is glabella. And this is ilion. Just above the ilion is the occipital point. So from glabella to occipital point, if you measure, this is farthest point of the head. If you see this, here is glabella, and here is this point is external occipital protuberance. And in center you can see in center, this is inion, inion. Just above to this, this point. This is farthest point. If you measure by calipers from here to here, this is farthest point. So this is the occipital point. Occipital point, inion, external occipital protuberance, and external occipital crest. Here you can see superior nuchal line. This is superior nuchal line, and here is inferior nuchal line. Inferior nuchal line, superior inferior nuchal line, and here you can see this process is breast-like process. This is mastoid process. Here is mastoid process, and here the suture is sagittal suture, and here is lambdoid suture. This is lambdoid suture. This is lambdoid suture. And this point is here. Lambda is present. And posterior fontanelle present up to 2 or 3 months of the life here. And here you can see there are under suture. This suture is parieto mastoid suture and occipito mastoid suture. Parieto mastoid and occipito mastoid suture here. And if you see, here is foramen. If you see this foramen, this is mastoid foramen. Through this mastoid foramen, here you can see the occipital artery. One branch, that is meningeal branch of occipital artery, passes through this foramen, occipital foramen. And emissary vein passes through this and communicate with the sigmoidal sinus. So this is all about the nerve occipitalis. Yes, now we'll discuss about the skull, norma basalis, base of the skull. This is base of the skull. You can see here, this is base of the skull. So first of all, make a diagram. Alveolar arch. In base, this is alveolar arch. Here the socket for the teeth. Here the socket for the teeth. This is alveolar arch. You can see this is alveolar arch. This is alveolar arch. This arch is alveolar arch. Here, root of tooth is present here. This is pyramidal process of the palatine. And here is cross-like suture. This part is this area. This is palatine process of maxilla. Palatine process of maxilla, and this part is horizontal plate of palatine. So anterior two-third part is formed by this palatine process of the maxilla, and posterior one-third by horizontal plate of palatine bone. Here lies suture, intermaxillary suture. This suture is from here to here. Here a fossa is present. This is known as incisive fossa. This fossa is known as incisive fossa.
Fossa foramen. Incisive foramen. Here.
From here,
two canal open.
These are the incisive canal.
So this is incisive foramen here.
Incisive canal passes and perforated to this foramen. Passes through this foramen.
This is intermaxillary suture.
Here is interpalatine suture. This is interpalatine suture. And this suture is palatomaxillary suture. This is palatomaxillary suture.
This is palate wound. This is maxilla.
This is palatomaxillary suture. This suture. And this is intermaxillary suture. And this is interpalatine suture. And this is pyramidal crossing of the palatine.
Pyramidal crossing of palatine wound.
And here,
if foramen is present, this is greater palatine foramen. And there are small two or three lesser palatine foramen present in this is in the pyramidal passage of the palatine. So these are small lesser palatine foramen.
So greater palatine foramen, these are lesser palatine foramen. This is posterior margin of the palatine bone,
and here is this is posterior nasal spine. This is posterior nasal spine.
This is posterior nasal spine.
And here, if you see, Bomer bone is attached here.
Bomer bone.
And this is the rostrum of the sphenoid.
If you make this diagram here,
this is Bomer bone, and these are the two ala of the Bomer bone. These are two ala of the Bomer bone, and this is rostrum of the sphenoid. Here is the body of the sphenoid. From here, the process goes towards this. This is vaginal process. This is known. This process is known as vaginal passage of sphenoid. This is sphenoid. This process, vaginal process of the sphenoid, goes here, and here a foramen is formed between these two. A foramen is formed here. This foramen is known as vomerovaginal. This is vomero. Vaginal canal.
So here the foramen communicates with the vomerovaginal canal. So vomerovaginal canal starts here through this foramen. This is ala. This foramen is between ala of the vomer.
This is vomer.
This is ala of the vomer, and this is vaginal passage of sphenoid.
Vaginal process of sphenoid bone. This is vaginal process of the sphenoid bone.
And under bone, here, you can see under bone,
this is horizontal plate of palatine,
horizontal plate of the palatine,
and here is vertical plate of the palatine, and it gives under process.
This process is known as
sphenoid process. This goes towards this sphenoid bone. This is sphenoid. So between this and this, there is under foramen here.
This foramen is vomerovaginal. This is palatovaginal.
This is palatovaginal this is palate to vaginal canal. So this palato-vaginal canal is formed between this vaginal process of sphenoid bone and sphenoidal process of palatine bone. So this is palatine bone, this is vertical part of vertical plate of palatine bone, this is horizontal plate of the palatine bone. So these two canals are formed here and here. And lateral to this is sphenoid bone, and this sphenoid bone joins with the basal occipital. This is basal occipital bone and basal part of the occipital bone, and form the broad bar. This is broad bar. This is formed by sphenoid bone, body of the sphenoid bone, and basal occipital, and here foramen magnum lies. This foramen magnum surrounded on lateral side by two condyles. These are the occipital condyles. And anterior to condyle, there is anterior condylar canal, and posterior to condyle, there is posterior condylar canal. Anterior condylar canal is also known as hypoglossal canal, because hypoglossal nerve passes through this. So this is anterior condylar canal, this is posterior condylar canal, this is condyle, occipital condyle, this is foramen magnum, this foramen is foramen magnum. So here you can see, this is foramen magnum, and on both sides there are two condyles, which is articular surface. So this condyle is occipital condyle. Anterior to this, you can see, anterior to this, a foramen is present, that is anterior condylar canal. And posterior to this, another foramen which forms the canal, this is posterior condylar canal. So anterior condylar canal and posterior condylar canal present here. And here you can see this bone is vomer. In midline you can see this is vomer, and this part is broad bar. This is broad bar. It is divided into two part. Anterior part is formed by body of sphenoid, and posterior part is formed by occipital bone. And in occipital part, there is tubercle is present here. This is known as pharyngeal tubercle. So here you can see a tubercle. This is pharyngeal tubercle. So here lies pharyngeal tubercle. You can see this. This is pharyngeal tubercle. And on each side, this is the sphenoid, body of the sphenoid, and here you have seen the process. And here pterygoid process is present, which has lateral pterygoid plate. Here you can see in this diagram, pterygoid process lies like this. This is pterygoid process. So this is lateral pterygoid, this is medial pterygoid. So here lies medial pterygoid, this is medial pterygoid, and another is lateral pterygoid. So another is lateral to this, lateral pterygoid. Here you can see this, in this diagram, this is lateral pterygoid and this is medial pterygoid. This is pterygoid process. So lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid. Lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid, medial and lateral pterygoid, lies here. And from here, lateral ring of sphenoid start, and here is
This is zygomatic bone, zygomatic arch.
And here lies, this is temporal fossa.
This is posterior part, and here, from here to here, this is external occipital crest and external occipital protuberance. Here are the superior nuchal line, here lies highest nuchal line, this is inferior nuchal line. So these lines are present here, you can see. This is external occipital protuberance, this is superior nuchal line, this is inferior nuchal line. And here is highest nuchal line. So from here to here, this is external occipital crest. And this is external occipital protuberance, where inian is present. This top point is inian.
So here is stylite process. This is position of the stylite process. This is mastoid process. Stylite process and there is mastoid process.
Here you can see this is mastoid process and there is stylite process. And between the stylite and mastoid process there is foramen. This is stylomastoid foramen.
This foramen is stylomastoid foramen between stylite process and mastoid process. Between stylite and mastoid process, there is foramen. This is stylomastoid foramen. This foramen is stylomastoid foramen. And here you can see foramen lacerum. Jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen and here lies foramen lacerum. This is foramen lacerum.
So here you can see this is jugular foramen. This foramen is jugular foramen. You can see this jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen. This foramen is jugular foramen. And here is foramen lacerum. You can see this is foramen lacerum. Here is foramen lacerum. And just anterior to jugular foramen, there is carotid canal.
This is jugular foramen and here lies carotid canal. This is carotid canal. This is foramen lacerum and here you will see foramen ovale and here is spinous process. So this is foramen spinosum. Foramen ovale, foramen spinosum. Foramen ovale, foramen spinosum. You can see here.
This is foramen ovale. This is foramen is ovale. This foramen is foramen ovale. And just and here you can see spinous process. Small spinous process. And in between these two, spine and foramen ovale, there is foramen spinosum. So this is foramen spinosum. This is small foramen. You can see foramen spinosum. So here is foramen lacerum, foramen ovale, and here is carotid canal. This is carotid canal. So here a tympanic plate is present. You can see this. This is tympanic plate. And here is mandibular fossa.
Just anterior tympanic plate. Then here is tympanic plate. Here lies mandibular fossa. This is mandibular fossa and here tympanic plate lies. Here is external acoustic meatus.
So this is external acoustic meatus
present on the lateral side. Here. So this is external acoustic meatus and here you can see this is tympanic plate and here
this is tubercle, articular tubercle. Just behind the articular tubercle this mandibular fossa is present. Here head of the mandible articulates. are about the Narva Basins. Thank you. Yes, now we'll discuss about the Narva frontalis, anterior view of the skull. So this is anterior view of the skull. So now make a diagram. Here the orbit, this is nasal aperture, anterior nasal opening. Here is two nasal bone. This is frontal bone, this is frontal bone. And here you can see this is maxilla. This is mandible. So here you can see this bone is frontal bone. So in anterior view, Narva frontalis, this is frontal bone. This bone is, this part is squamous part of the frontal bone. Here are two major bones, major bone, and this bone is zygomatic bone. From here to here, this is zygomatic bone and this is maxilla. This bone is maxilla. This is maxilla. So, this is maxilla, zygomatic bone, frontal bone, nasal bone. This is mandible. Here, this is mandible. This part, this is body of the mandible. Here is the ramus of the mandible. This is anterior nasal opening, anterior nasal aperture. Here is anterior nasal spine. So this part is anterior nasal spine. So if you move from above downward, you can see this is frontal bone. In frontal bone, there is two eminences present. This is frontal protuberance. This is known as frontal protuberance. And here superciliary arch. This is superciliary arch is present. This is superciliary arch. So between these two superciliary arch, this area is prominent. This is known as glabella. This is glabella. This is glabella. And just below this glabella, this point is inion. This point is inion. Sorry, nasion. This point is nasion. Nasion. This is nasion. Here. This is internasal suture. Here, internasal suture. So two nasal bones and frontal bone joined here. This is frontal bone joined here and form the nasion. And here is orbit. In orbit, you can see it has four margins. This is superior margin. This is lateral margin. This is inferior margin. This is medial margin. In superior margin, there is here a notch is present. This is supraorbital notch. This is sometimes foramen is also present here. This is supraorbital notch. Sometimes here the foramen is present. The foramen is present like this. This is supraorbital foramen or notch. Mostly notch is present. Through this supraorbital vessels and nerves passes. Supraorbital vessel and nerve passes through this supraorbital notch. And this margin is made up of, you can see, this margin is made up of, here this is frontal bone. And here this is lateral side, it is lateral margin, upper part is made up of, this upper part is made up of frontal bone and lower part is made up of zygomatic bone. And here inferior margin is made up of zygomatic bone and maxilla. And this medial margin is made up of, this is anterior lacrimal crest and frontal bone. Anterior lacrimal crest and frontal bone. This is anterior lacrimal crest of the maxilla and frontal bone. So this form the medial arch. And here this is orbit. And after orbit you go downward. Here you will find this is infraorbital foramen. So this infraorbital foramen, infraorbital nerve and vessels passes. Supraorbital notch, this is infraorbital foramen. Through infraorbital foramen, infraorbital nerve and vessels passes. And here in zygomatic bone, here a foramen is present. This is zygomatico facial foramen. Zygomaticofacial foramen, through this zygomaticofacial nerve and vessel passes. If you move downward from here, you can see this is maxilla. This maxilla has three processes. One process which is going upward is towards the frontal bone, is a frontal process of the maxilla. And here, this part, this process goes towards the zygomatic bone. This is zygomatic process of the maxilla. And here, alveolar process of the maxilla, which bears root of teeth. So, this is alveolar process of the maxilla, zygomatic process of the maxilla, and frontal process of the maxilla. And on medial side, here a notch is formed. and both sides are joined to form the anterior nasal aperture. This is anterior nasal aperture. Here, inferiorly in this aperture, anterior nasal spine is present. This is spine-like process. This is anterior nasal spine. This anterior nasal spine is present. Here is anterior maxillary suture, intermaxillary suture between two maxilla, intermaxillary suture. Here is internasal suture. And below to this, here is a mandible. Mandible has body and this part is a ramus. Body, VS, this is a stockage on the alveolar margin. This is alveolar margin. Here root of teeth is attached with these sockets. And here in midline, this is symphysis menti. Symphysis menti. And here is mental protuberance. This is mental protuberance and here lies foramina. These are the mental foramen. These are the mental foramen. Mental foramen. So this is norma frontalis or anterior view of the skull. If you see here, same thing. This is frontal bone. This point is here is superciliary arch. This is glabella. Here are nasal bone, internasal suture. This part, this aperture is anterior nasal aperture. And here you can see anterior nasal spine. So this is anterior nasal spine. You can see this is spine is here, anterior nasal spine. And here alveolar process is present. And this is orbit. Superior margin, lateral margin, inferior margin, medial margin. And here in superior margin there is a notch. You can see this notch on superior margin. This notch is supraorbital notch. And inferiorly you can see this is foramen. This is infraorbital foramen. And in zygomatic bone you can see zygomaticofacial foramen here. This is zygomaticofacial foramen. And here you can see the mandible. This is mental foramen here. Mental foramen is present. And this is anterior nasal aperture. This bone is zygomatic bone. This bone is zygomatic bone. This bone is maxilla. Maxilla. So frontal, zygomatic, nasal, maxilla. And here this is mandible. So these bones are present in the norma frontalis. So this is all about the norma frontalis. Thank you. Just now we'll discuss about the norma lateralis, lateral view of the skull. This is lateral view of the skull. So first of all, we'll make a diagram. Here is position of Islam writings, Latin view. In this view, you can see, here is temporal line, superior, this is inferior temporal line, and here one suture is present. This is superior temporal line, this is inferior temporal line. Here, this is coronal suture, this is parieto squamous suture, this is parieto squamous suture. This is temporal bone, this bone from here to here, this bone is temporal bone. So this part of temporal bone is squamous part. So this is parietal bone, parieto squamous suture, parieto squamous suture. And here is, this is occipital bone, occipital bone. Here is position of esterion, and this is position of this point where four bones meet. This bone is frontal bone. This is frontal bone, this is parietal bone, and here is, this is a squamous part of temporal bone, and this is greater ring of sphenoid. So here four bones meet, and this meeting point is yet shaped. This is known as tibia. This is tibium, and here is esterion. We have already discussed in Norma occipitalis. This bone is frontal, parietal, squamous part of temporal bone. This is sphenoid bone, greater ring of sphenoid. So this point is tibia. This is superior temporal line, this is inferior temporal line. This is zygomatic arch. So this is zygomatic arch. This zygomatic arch is made up of two parts, posterior part and anterior part. Anterior part, this part here. This is process. This is process of the zygomatic bone. This bone is zygomatic bone. So this is temporal process of zygomatic bone. And this part, it is zygomatic process of temporal bone. So this is zygomatic process of temporal bone. So from here to here, this is bar-like bony structure. It has superior border, inferior border, medial surface, lateral surface. This is zygomatic arch. So anterior part is made up of temporal process of zygomatic bone. Posterior part, this part is formed by zygomatic process of temporal bone, and here this part, here a depression is present on side of the skull. You can see this is zygomatic arch. Here you can see this is zygomatic arch, this is arch. Here is suture. This is zygomatic bone and this is temporal bone. So this part is zygomatic process of temporal bone, and this is temporal process of the zygomatic bone. This bone is zygomatic bone. So zygomatic bone, this is zygomatic arch. So this fossa on the lateral side, this is depression. This is known as temporal fossa. This fossa is temporal fossa. And here, this is muscular process. This is styloid process. Here is external epistaxis meatus. So above the mastoid process, this is mastoid process, breast-like process. Above to this, here is triangular. This triangle is present. This is known as Mac Ewant triangle. It is also like supra mastoid triangle or supra meatal triangle. So this is supra meatal triangle. It is lies above the external epistaxis meatus or supramastoid triangle. Here supramastoid crest lies here, so it forms superior boundary, and clearly posterior margin of this posterior margin of the external epistaxis meatus and posterior boundary is formed by a vertical tangent passing from the margin of the posterior, from posterior margin of the external epistaxis meatus. So this is vertical tangent. So this is supramiatal triangle, supramiatal triangle or supramastoid triangle. At Mac Ewant triangle. This triangle is clinically important because about 1.25 cm deep to this mastoid antrum is present. Mastoid antrum is present here about 1.25 cm deep to this. So this is clinically important. One other thing, here is occipital bone. This is occipital bone. This one is maxilla. Maxilla. Below to this temporal fossa, here you can see below the zygomatic arch, below the temporal fossa, there is infratemporal fossa. Here you can see below the zygomatic arch, there is a fossa. This is known as infratemporal fossa. So this here is infratemporal fossa. So this area infratemporal fossa, and as you know, this is mandible. This is mandible. This is maxilla. This bone is maxilla, and here you can see there is another bone. This is nasal bone. This is orbit. So this is norma lateralis. You can see in this. Here is frontal bone, parietal bone, occipital bone. This is temporal bone. Here you can see this is temporal bone. Here is temporal line, superior and inferior temporal line. This is zygomatic arch, external epistaxis meatus, mastoid process. This is mastoid process. And here you can see styloid process lies here. Styloid process is broken. Styloid process, mastoid process. This is mandible. And here one another thing, a tubercle is present in the lower margin of this. This is articular tubercle. This tubercle is present on the inferior border of the zygomatic arch. This is articular tubercle. Here this is mandibular fossa is present. Here mandibular fossa is present. Mandibular articulates, here you can see this is mandibular fossa. This head of the mandibular articulates with the mandibular fossa. So anterior to this fossa, this is articular tubercle. So this is articular tubercle. And here tympanic plate, this is tympanic plate around the external epistaxis meatus. The plate is present, this is known as tympanic plate. So here you can see around this tympanic plate is present. So this is all about the Narma lateris, a lateral view of the skull. Thank you. Yes, now we'll discuss about the medial cranial fossa. In previous lecture, you have seen the anterior cranial fossa. Today, we'll discuss about the medial cranial fossa, this part in medial cranial fossa. If you see the boundary of the medial cranial fossa, it is anteriorly bounded by, this is lesser wing of the sphenoid, anterior clinoid process, and there is anterior margin of, this is anterior margin of sulcus chiasmaticus. This is sulcus chiasmaticus, anterior margin of the sulcus chiasmaticus. So this is anterior boundary. Lesser wing of the sphenoid, anterior clinoid process, and anterior margin of sulcus chiasmaticus. And posteriorly, here is, this is dorsum sellae. This is dorsum sellae, posterior clinoid process, and this is superior edge of petrous temporal bone. This is superior edge of the petrous temporal bone, or superior border of the petrous temporal bone. So this is anterior boundary, this is posterior boundary, this is posterior boundary, and on each side, if you see on lateral side, here, laterally, this bone is, if you may, this is the sphenoid bone, so laterally, here, some part of the sphenoid, and this part is parietal bone, sphenoid parietal, and here some part of this flat part is squamous. There is flat part of the, or the squamous part of the temporal bone. So this part is lateral margin, lateral boundary. Now floor. Floor is formed by greater wing of sphenoid, here petrous temporal bone, and this part is parietal bone. Parietal bone. So here you can see this part. This part is body of the sphenoid. Here one, this is tuberculum sellae. This is tuberculum sellae, and from here on lateral side projection from the middle, from the lateral side form the middle clinoid process. So here is anterior clinoid process, this is medial clinoid process. Sometimes this anterior and medial clinoid process join to form single process. And this is posterior clinoid process. And this is body of this sphenoid. From tuberculum sellae to dorsum sellae, from tuberculum sellae to this dorsum sellae, there is hypopygial fossa. This is hypopygial fossa here. Pituitary gland is situated. This is known as Turkish sidle. This is Turkish sidle. This is like Turkish sidle. This is hypophysial fossa. If you go lateral to this, here is superior orbital fissure. Superior orbital fissure. Here a small projection is present through which common tendinous rim of gin is attached, and here is one opening. This is foramen. This foramen is foramen rotundum. This is foramen rotundum.
and here is foramen ovale, lateral side to this there is foramen ovale, and lateral to this there is foramen spinosum. This is foramen spinosum. Medial to this foramen ovale, this is foramen ovale. Medial to this, sometimes small foramen are present. These are sphenoidal emissary foramina Vesalius. Sphenoidal emissary foramina Vesalius. And laterally, sometimes between foramen spinosum and foramen ovale, sometimes some foramen is present. These are known as innominate foramen. These are innominate foramen. These are sphenoidal emissary foramen through this emissary vein passes. And if this foramen is present, then some fibers are lesser pectoral nerve passes through this. So from here, this is superior arbitral fissure, foramen rotundum. This foramen rotundum, it leads anteriorly into the pterygopalatine fossa. Through this, maxillary nerve passes. This is foramen ovale. It leads to the infratemporal fossa, and through this mandibular nerve, accessory meningeal artery, lesser pectoral nerve, and emissary vein passes. And here, through this sphenoidal emissary foramen, emissary vein passes, and through foramen spinosum, middle meningeal artery passes. So these are foramina, and one foramen lies here. This is foramen lacerum. So this part is this foramen is foramen lacerum. So here one foramen is present. This is foramen lacerum. If you cut a section here, you can see this is pectus temporal bone, apex of the pectus temporal bone. This is paracerebellar section, and here this is foramen lacerum. This is anterior wall of the foramen lacerum. This is anterior wall of the foramen lacerum. In anterior wall of the foramen lacerum, there is a canal. This is pterygoid canal. This is pterygoid canal. And this is pterygoid process. Pterygoid process. And here is pterygoid canal. And in this part, this pectus temporal bone, here is canal is present. This is carotid canal. It passes like this, and carotid internal carotid artery passes through this. So this is carotid canal through which it passes. This is internal carotid artery. This is internal carotid artery passes through this. So you can see this is position of the foramen lacerum. See, in upper part it passes and goes like this. And here cartilage is present. This is cartilage. Through this foramen lacerum is closed, and through this cartilage one structure, that is emissary vein passes from here. This is pterygoid vein passes from here. Emissary vein passes, and here is position of the cavernous sinus. It goes into the cavernous sinus. This is dural vein sinus. So it communicates with the cavernous sinus. And another important thing, through this pterygoid canal, one branch of the facial nerve passes. That branch is greater petrosal nerve. This is greater petrosal nerve passes through this. This is greater petrosal nerve. Greater petrosal nerve. And one another nerve which form here plexus. This is sympathetic nerve which form plexus around the internal carotid artery. From here one branch arise, this branch passes through this foramen. This is deep petrosal nerve. So this is deep petrosal nerve. So greater petrosal nerve and deep petrosal nerve join to form here nerve to pterygoid canal. So these two nerves join to form nerve to pterygoid canal. Nerve to pterygoid canal. So here this is foramen lacerum. This is foramen lacerum. Another important thing here, this is pectoral temporal bone. In this pectoral temporal bone, you can see some impressions. Here is one impression is present. This is known as trigeminal impression. Here is one impression. This is trigeminal impression. Here trigeminal ganglion is present and a trigeminal cave is formed here. So this is trigeminal impression. Another important thing here is foramen. This is hiatus and root for the greater petrosal nerve. So it is hiatus and root for the greater petrosal nerve. This is hiatus and this is hiatus. This is opening hiatus and this is root. This is opening and hiatus of the greater petrosal nerve. So this is greater petrosal nerve, which is a branch of the facial nerve. It passes through this and here goes into the foramen lacerum and it passes through the anterior wall of the foramen lacerum and joins the deep petrosal nerve from the nerve to pterygoid canal. So this nerve is greater petrosal nerve and this opening is hiatus and from here to here there is a groove in the bone. This is groove for the greater petrosal nerve. And under lateral to this there is another opening. This is hiatus and groove for the lesser petrosal nerve. Lesser petrosal nerve, hiatus and groove for lesser petrosal nerve. Lesser petrosal nerve here arises from the tympanic plexus and carries fibers from the ninth pineal nerve. So from here it goes through foramen ovale. So this is hiatus and groove for the lesser petrosal nerve and it leads towards the foramen ovale. And as you know, through foramen ovale, mandibular nerve, accessory meningeal artery, lesser petrosal nerve and emissary vein passes. So this is lesser petrosal nerve which passes through this and goes to the infratemporal fossa and in intratemporal fossa it gives supply to parotid gland. So this is lesser petrosal nerve. Hiatus and group for lesser petrosal nerve. And later to this there is arcuate eminence. Arcuate eminence is for the superior semicircular canal. And if you see on the back side here, this part we discuss in posterior carotid fossa. So this is all about the middle carotid fossa. Thank you. Yes, now we will discuss about the posterior carotid fossa. So this is posterior carotid fossa. This part is posterior carotid fossa, boundary of the posterior carotid fossa. Here is dorsal semi, posterior clinoid process and superior border of the pectus temporal bone anteriorly and posteriorly from here to here. This is the squamous part of the occipital bone. So squamous part of the occipital bone. And lastly, some part here you can see. This is mastoid angle of the parietal bone, and some part of the mastoid part of the temporal bone here. So floor is formed by from here to here. This slope is clevus. This is clevus. Here pharyngeal tubercle is present. Pharyngeal tubercle is present on the infratemporal region, on the inferior surface. So this is clevus. This slope is clevus. Here basilar plexus is present. So from here to here, this slope is known as clevus. And here you can see here is foramen. This foramen is jugular foramen. This is jugular foramen. And here is internal. This is internal acoustic meatus. This is internal acoustic meatus. This is foramen magnum. And here is anterior side. There is hypoglossal canal. And posteriorly, here is a Vermeer fossa is present. This is Vermeer fossa, and this is here is internal occipital crest. This is internal occipital crest, and from here this is group part transverse sinus. This is group part transverse sinus on each side. Here this part is confluence of the sinuses. Here superior serrated sinus and transverse sinus meets, and here occipital sinus passes through this. Here is fossa on each side. This fossa is known as cerebellar fossa. Here lies cerebellum, two hemisphere of the cerebellum. This is internal occipital crest. Here is internal occipital protuberance. This is foramen magnum. We have the sulcus for the transverse sinus. If you see here, if fracture occurs during head injury, this bone is fractured. Pectus part of the temporal bone is fractured, or middle fossa is fractured here. There may be chance of the bleeding and CSF passes through the ear, through the external acoustic meatus. CSF or blood comes out in case of fracture of the metacarpian fossa. In case of fracture of the anterior tail fossa, blood or CSF passes through nose. So this is all about the posterior tail fossa.
Yes, now we'll discuss about the anatomy of the mandible. So this is mandible, it is lower jawbone. It is made up of two half part joined here at the symphysis menti. This is symphysis menti. Here two half part fuse during first year of life, This is symphysis mentale. If you see, this is lateral view of the mandible, anterolateral side of the mandible. This is anterolateral view. This part is body, from here to here, this part is body of the mandible, and this part is from here to here, this is ramus. Between body and ramus, if you see here is angle, this is 110 degree angle in adult, and in infant or in child, it is about 140 degree in child, and in old age, it is also become 140 degree. So in adult, it is about 110 degree. So this is angle between the posterior part of the ramus and base. So this angle, if you make this line, so here is angle. So this is this part of the angle. This is angle. This angle is about 110 in adult. This is anterolateral surface. If you remove or separate each two half and see another part, see this part at the inner surface, then you will find this is inner surface here, this part. This is this surface, and this diagram is this surface, inner surface. Here you can see, here is symphysis mentale. This is side where two half of the mandible joins with each other. Here is superior genial tubercle, this is inferior genial tubercle. This superior genial tubercle gives attachment to genioglossus muscle. Here is genioglossus muscle. So it is genioglossus muscle attached to this, and here is like higher bone. This is inferior genial tubercle, it gives attachment to geniohyoid. So this is geniohyoid. This is genioglossus. This is genioglossus. So this muscle is genioglossus, attached to superior genial tubercle, and inferior genial tubercle gives attachment to geniohyoid muscle. This optic line here, you can see, this is myelohyoid line. This is myelohyoid line. This is myelohyoid line. Below to this, here is
hollow space, hollow fossa. This is submantic. This fossa is for the submandibular gland. That's why submandibular fossa. Submandibular fossa. Above to this, here sublingual gland situated. That's why this is sublingual fossa. This is sublingual fossa. And on inner side, you can see here, this is mandibular foramen. This mandibular foramen leads into mandibular canal, and this canal opens on the lateral surface. Here you can see inner surface. This is mandibular foramen, and it leads into outer surface. Here, this is mental foramen. From mental foramen to mandibular foramen, a canal is present, that is known as mandibular canal. So, from here, this is mandibular foramen, and here lies mental foramen, which is present on the lateral surface. This is mental foramen. So this is mental foramen, present on the lateral side. Here this mandibular canal, this is position of the mental foramen here. This is mental foramen. Mental foramen present on the anterior lateral side, not in medial side. Medial side, mandibular foramen is present. So canal from here, this foramen to this is mandibular canal. And then important thing, here is a tongue-like projection. This tongue-like projection in the anterior side of this foramen. This is known as a lingula. This lingula is attached with sphenomandibular nerve. Sphenomandibular ligament. This sphenomandibular ligament typically attached to the spina of the sphenoid. And this foramen, through this foramen, inferior alveolar artery, this is inferior alveolar artery, it passes and here comes as mental artery. So inferior alveolar artery passes through this and here it becomes mental artery. This is level of the foramen and it comes here, this passes like this. And nerve, inferior alveolar nerve passes through this and it comes out through this foramen. Inferior alveolar nerve passes through this. Remember, inferior alveolar nerve is a branch of posterior division of mandibular nerve. So inferior alveolar nerve is a branch of, this is inferior alveolar nerve. It is a branch of posterior division of mandibular nerve. And another thing, here this artery, inferior alveolar artery, it is a branch of first part of the maxillary artery. First part of the maxillary artery gives this branch. This is the first part of the maxillary artery. So inferior alveolar artery. It is also accompanying the vein. So this body has superior border, inferior border from the base, anterior border, and posteriorly it continue with this ramus. And ramus has anterior border, superior border, posterior border, and inferior border. Inferior border of this joins with the base. So here is head, this is neck. On the anterior surface of the neck, there is depression known as pterygoid fovea. Pterygoid fovea. Here lateral pterygoid muscle is inserted. This is pterygoid fovea. Here lateral pterygoid muscle is attached
lateral pterygoid muscle is inserted here.
So here muscle, lateral pterygoid is attached. And this head is covered by fibrocartilage. And it takes part in formation of temporomandibular joint. And then important thing, here is, this is part of rhymus. Rhymus has two processes. This is coronoid process, this is condyloid process. Condyloid process has head, neck. Coronoid process, you can see, coronoid means hota hai crow. Like beak of crow. So here, on the medial surface and anterior border and posterior border here, the muscle is attached, this muscle is temporalis muscle. This muscle is temporalis. So this temporalis muscle is attached here. And anterior border and inner surface. And also some part of the posterior border. And here, at the side of the ankle, on inner side, the rough area, it gives attachment to the medial pterygoid muscle. Here, medial pterygoid muscle is attached, inserted. And one other thing, this is inferior alveolar nerve and vessel, just below to this, here, and the groove is present, that groove is known as myohyoid groove. So this myohyoid groove, myohyoid nerve and myohyoid vessels passes, myohyoid nerve and vessels passes, this is myohyoid groove, this is myohyoid groove, this is myohyoid line, you have seen this is myohyoid line, so this line myohyoid muscle is attached. So this myohyoid, the nerve to myohyoid gives supply to this, and here this nerve to myohyoid gives supply to another structure, here is digestive fossa. This is digestive fossa. Here anterior belly of the digestive muscle is attached. So anterior belly of the digestive muscle lies here. Here lies posterior belly. So this is anterior belly of the digestive. This is supplied by nerve to myohyoid. So this nerve to myohyoid is supplied to myohyoid muscle and anterior belly of the digestive, which is attached to the digestive fossa here. So, this is all about the inner aspect of the mandible. Inner aspect, that means this aspect, you can see. Coronoid process, condyloid process, this is neck, here is pterygoid fovea, and this is foramen. Here you can see at the angle, rough area, here medial pterygoid is attached, this is medial pterygoid is attached. Now, we'll move on the lateral surface, anterolateral surface. This is anterolateral surface. Here you can see this is anterior border of the rhymus. Here is oblique line. This is oblique line. Here you can see this is body. This is the rhymus. This body here. Rhymus, the attachment of the temporalis muscle, here is pterygoid fovea, here that pterygoid muscle is attached, and this is site where the lateral side masseter muscle is attached. So this is the attachment of masseter muscle is attached here. And the thing, here you can see also, here advertisement of the one ligament this ligament is this is pterygomandibular ligament here is pterygomandibular ligament pterygomandibular ligament attached here and another thing here near to this there is some fiber of superior constrictor of the pharynx so superior constrictor of the pharynx is also attached here superior constrictor of the pharynx and here on this side you can see this is here is incisive fossa there is depression below the incisor is this incisive fossa and here you can see mental protuberance so this triangular area in this side this is mental protuberance so here you can see this is mental protuberance this is mental protuberance and below the insert this incisive fossa incisive fossa just below to this incisor teeth and here this is mental protuberance and lateral to this inferior lateral part of this protuberance is mental tubercle so here lies mental tubercle this is mental protuberance and this is mental tubercle mental tubercle and here another structures one muscle is attached to this side this is buccinator this muscle is attached buccinator so here buccinator muscle is attached and here another muscle depressor labii inferioris depressor anguli oris and mentalis muscle is here so these muscles are attached here and then see here platysma muscle is here. This is platysma muscle which is attached here platysma so this is all about the anterior lateral surface of the mandible it has body ramus has four borders anterior posterior superior and one important thing here this masseter is supplied by mastic nerve and mastic vessel the mastic and nerve vessel passes through this concave part this is mandibular notch this concavity is known as mandibular notch mandibular notch if you see difference in childhood adulthood and in old age here you can see this angle between this and this part this body and ramus in adult angle is 110 in children 140 and in old age 140 and position of this mental foramen in children its position is here in old age its position is here in children its position is near the base and in old age its position is near the superior border and in adult it lies between these two borders so this is position of the mental foramen through which mental nerve and vessels passes now ossification this is second bone in the body which ossify it ossify from membranous ossification and also cartilaginous ossification so first pharyngeal arch cartilage is known as Meckel's cartilage between mental foramen
to mandibular foramen, between mental foramen to this level of the mandibular foramen, this area is ossified from membrane. That is mesenchymal sheath of the Meckel's cartilage, this part ossified. Ossification starts during 6 weeks of intraepiphyseal life, and rest part, this part, anterior part, anterior to this foramen, this part ossified from cartilage, Meckel's cartilage. And these two processes are ossified from secondary cartilage. And now applied aspect, fracture. Fracture is very common here, near the incisive fossa. One side is fracture at the angle and the side and at the neck. So these are the common side of the fracture of the mandible. So this is all about the mandible. Thank you.